Penguin Random House Canada presents This Country Is No Longer Yours by Avik Jain Chatlani. Read for you by Michel, Issa, Rubio, Marcelo, Arroyo, and Arlen, Aguayo, Stewart. 1. Year Zero. The train passes several towns and villages. He stops keeping count. Everything looks the same. Pagodas, thatched roofs, colonies of bungalows, lakes. And then, everything stops. The dark green forest shrouds the windows. There are no more bicycles, no more people, only trees. At the end of the line, the conductor is nervous. He shouts at the doctoral student, orders him to get off, quickly. He grabs his knapsack and his books, leaves his seat, jumps down onto the platform. The train is already pulling away, going backwards, back into the jungle. The station is still shrouded by trees, but there aren't so many. He can see above them. He can see clear blue skies and shining sun. His white shirt and cotton pants are drenched with sweat. He can see the hairs on his stomach through the fabric. He sits on a bench for hours. He is then moved to an empty room, given a bowl of sticky rice. He eats and sits, waiting, waiting, waiting for what? For the end of the world? That's what the professor sent him here to see. The end of the world. Finally, a rusty American-made car pulls up on the dirt road beside the station. A chubby man in a checkered scarf and black Mao jacket rushes out of the back seat to welcome him. They shake hands, embrace. They speak French. What a relief, French. After all those clicks and gulps and purrs, finally a language the student can speak with ease. He took French classes in Catholic school and still reads French writers in his university library. He is ushered into the car, pressed into the burning back seat. They drive off, kicking up dirt, sputtering into the border town. The chubby man apologizes for everything. Over the clanging engine, he apologizes for the train, for the long wait, for his sweat, for the journey, for the shortage of cars. Cars are banned in the New Republic. We only use a few for official business. It can't be avoided. You understand. And he finds other things to apologize for as the student looks out the window. The land is strong. His host nods vigorously. The land is strong. Through the open windows, he breathes in something like the sharp smell of dung. But it is sweeter, more soothing. The flowers numb his face and weigh down on his eyes. They flutter as he listens to his host prattle on about production figures. The humidity fogs up his glasses. After the clarity of the day, everything becomes a haze that he must keep wiping away. When he reaches the capital, he sees that it is deserted. The low-rise buildings are rotting in neglect. The white paint is peeling. The steel shutters covering the storefronts are sinking into the ground. Bodies of stray dogs are piled on street corners. The carcasses picked apart by birds. The smell of sewage and spoiled food hangs in the air. His host provides him with a handkerchief. They ride around the city, cloth over their mouths, and, without pausing for breath, the host tells the student about the city that is now a museum of the old society. No more gasoline. No more electricity. No more television or radio. No more casinos. No more brothels. No more schools. No more hospitals. No more barracks. No more stores. No more money. No more hotels. No more construction. No more foreign factories. No more factories. No more foreigners. No more. No more. There is no shortage of shade. Empty buildings loom over crumbling streets, creating shadows that make everything look like it is moving. The student trembles when he walks down a boulevard. It is empty, but it feels full of ghosts. He rushes back to the car as soon as the tour is over. It's a ghost town. Comrade, ghosts don't exist. No, I mean, it's abandoned. His host smiles. Yes, yes, abandoned, evacuated. Yes, There had been a city here, a city teeming with hundreds of thousands of people. But they were not really people. They were slaves. Slaves to the old system. Slaves to the king, the foreigners. We came out of the forest, and we saved them. They emptied all of the cities and towns. They evacuated everyone. Each person was only allowed one basket of belongings. They could only bring bicycles. All cars were confiscated. All other possessions were confiscated. Not for the use of the leadership. Not at all. But for the collective use. He is famished. Even the smell of the rotting dogs and the clogged sewers cannot repress his hunger any longer. He must eat. Something. Anything. He finds the nerve to tell his host, and the apologies begin again. His host is ashamed. How can you treat a guest in this manner? The driver whisks them away from the empty streets. They drive down a long road to a villa by the river. The air is fresh. The villa has been converted into a guest house. The doctoral student is given his own room. He doesn't have to share with the French communists or the Chinese consultants. He has a Western toilet instead of a squat toilet. The room has beautiful wooden floors, a high ceiling, doors that lead to a private patio. Hundreds of birds have settled in the trees to shriek. He watches the army of colors. When the city was evacuated, household macaws were released from their cages. Their owners were no longer able to care for them. They became wild. Careful never to venture too far into the forest, fearing the hunger of the workers. Their colors dazzle. The bright white around their shocked eyes stands out. Streaks of neon blue and yellow and green take to the sky. Their vigilant heads bob constantly, as if separate from their bodies. They stand guard on the branches and swoop down to taste the water of the river. When the macaws grow bored and fly away, his good mood also disappears. After taking copious notes for the professor, he goes downstairs and eats on the floor with his host. A tiny woman brings them bowls of soup, pork and rice, chicken and chili paste. He eats greedily. He copies his host and shovels in the food, bringing the bowls so close to his mouth that his inexperience with chopsticks doesn't matter. The distance is so short. He burns himself and doesn't care. He needs to silence the pangs in his stomach. The woman who brings them food smells heavily of spices. She is also the cook. She works in this villa. She cooks all the meals, and she weighs nothing. She's only bone and pained expressions. He mentions this to his host. His voice is low, sharp. She's from a landlord family. She is lucky to be here at all. She has the same rations as the other cooks, but he sees no other cooks. He only sees her glance into the bowls as she delivers them. The host doesn't bother looking at her. He only concentrates on the dishes, slurping, chewing, patting on more fat for the lean times should he ever fall out of favor. As his host drinks his rice wine, the student slips away to the kitchen and corners the cook. "Do you want some of my food?" She blinks at this offer. He asks again, "Would sneaking her a few bites make a difference?" She looks close to death.
"They will know."
"How will they know?" She shrugs.
"They always know."
He goes back to the dining area. They finish the bottle. They pass out in his room. They sleep for hours, until it is time to go and meet the others. They wake up with the sun and wash quickly, rinsing out their mouths with cold mint tea. He searches for the cook as they eat noodles and pigeon eggs, but he doesn't see her. Somebody else serves them, a young boy. Even the host takes pity on him. Slips him a packet of Chinese crackers. He shoves them into his mouth and swallows them, coughing. They tell him to slow down. He doesn't understand them. He gives a chewed-up smile. "Where are your parents?" The doctoral student asks the boy in French. He doesn't understand. He asks his host to translate. Hesitation. He eventually says something to the boy, who immediately dashes away upon hearing it. Where are his parents?
They are probably deeper in the countryside.
He must miss them. And there are sobs from the kitchen. The Chinese and French visitors look up from their breakfast. They also hear the crying, then the shouting, then a slap, then silence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.